not just anybody.
Help!
You know I need someone.
Help!
When I was younger, so much younger than today, I never needed anybody's help in any way. But now these days are gone, I'm not so self-assured.
Now
I find I've changed my mind and open up the doors. Help me if you can, I'm feeling down, and I do appreciate you being around. Help me get my feet back on the ground. Won't you please, please help me?
Hi, everybody. I'm Beatty Cohn-Vredos, and welcome again to the Ask Beatty Show. And I hope that the Beatles lyrics really do resonate with you, because whether or not we are rich or poor or black or white or Christian or Jewish or Muslim or gay or straight or queer or trans, the reality is, or therapist, by the way, the reality is that we all go through so many, so many ups and downs in our lives. And sometimes we just feel that we are on a never, never ending merry-go-round ride or a roller coaster ride, and not a fun ride. And we simply are at loose ends, and we just don't know what to do. And what I have been trying to encourage you and convince you for the last almost 270 Ask Beatty shows here on the Progressive Radio Network, that it is a good thing, that it is a strength, that it is not a weakness to reach out and ask for help. Whether or not you're dealing with depression. And in fact, there are 16 million adults in the United States. And when I read that statistics, I really intuitively know that that statistic is low. It really translates into 1 in 5 Americans. 40 million adults are suffering from a variety of different anxiety disorders. Or maybe you're someone that you're finding yourself, you're drinking too much, you're popping too many Valiums or Adderalls, and you're going to the doctor on a very, very regular basis, like a number of my patients have done over the years, and that you are coming out with a variety of different prescription medications for depression and anxiety and sleep. And you feel like you're just going around in circles. And of course, in this country, there is just way, way too much over-prescribing of a variety of different psychiatric medications, which is not to say that nobody should ever be prescribed a medication for depression or anxiety, certainly, or bipolar disorder, or schizophrenia, or other, you know, very serious, serious mental disorders. But we are taking too many pills without really getting to the root of the problem. And of course, relationships, which is something that I hear about in my private practice here in New York City and East Hampton continually, that people are just so frustrated. They're either frustrated with their partners, or they're frustrated because they don't have partners, and they feel like they're just going around in circles and are not just sure what to do, which is why I've always felt that the wise people, before we all bottom out, realize that it is a good thing to get a second opinion when you find that your life and when you find that your relationship is really not working out in the ways that you hoped. And that includes finances. And, you know, I encourage people on a very, very regular basis to take an honest, in-depth assessment of where they are across the board. It's not just your sex life. It's not just your relationship life. But also, if you're really wanting to create the life that you want, there are a number of different areas that we need to look at honestly and see where are we at, where have we been, and much more importantly, where do we want to go and how are we going to get there, including money. Are you satisfied? Are you satisfied where you are financially, or do you need to get a little bit of advice? And for a lot of people in this country, unfortunately, it means getting a second job, and for other people, a third job. But for a lot of people, they need to sit down. They need to sit down with a financial person and just figure out, what can I do, even if I'm not making a lot of money, to begin to perhaps to save, to be able to move forward with my financial life. And what about your career? I mean, careers these days, things have changed so much. I know when I look back at my own life, people had maybe one or maybe two careers, and now there's so much change in business, and careers have changed so much in the last number of years that people are having to switch and change and go back to school. And there are more and more people who are wanting to have startup companies, so that, again, if you're not sure about where you should be going with your business life, with your career life, with your money life, again, just reaching out and getting a second opinion and getting a new perspective, perhaps, can really make all the difference in the world. And of course, looking at your personal life, how things are really going mentally and emotionally and spiritually. And do you feel that you are in a good place, or do you feel that you are stuck and you're just not sure what to do? And again, you know, when people think about counseling, a lot of people believe that you're going to be in counseling forevermore, but that's not at all true. It's about figuring out what the issues are, and there may be some what I call skeletons in the closet and some unfinished business from our childhoods that we need to emotionally be able to sort out, so that we will be able to live better in the moment without having one foot in the past and one foot in the present. But again, getting second opinions. I mean, athletes do this all the time. They have coaches, they have trainers. We were watching Wimbledon the last several days, and you look at the team of people that support the Serena Williams and the Cocos and all of the great athletes of the world. Nobody is doing this on their own. And this is one of the things that I try to encourage you every single week here on the Ask Beatty Show, that life is stressful and challenging, and I think in certain ways probably more stressful and challenging than it's been in a long, long time, and that we don't need to do this on our own. And whether or not we're talking about therapy or friends or groups or getting second opinions, I mean, it really can make and does make all the difference in the world when you don't feel that you are so alone, when you don't feel so alone in your life. And what about your health? I mean, Gary Null talks about this all the time, the things that we can do every single day to improve the quality of our health. Of course, he talks about plant-based diets and fruits and vegetables and grains and fish and nuts. And again, you have to ask yourself, are you doing what is really in your best interest when it comes to your health, when it comes to your mental health, when it comes to your relationship, when it comes to your sex life? You know, exercise. And I have people who tell me all the time, we know that we should be going to the gym. We know what all the studies tell us about how exercise improves not only our physicality, but our mental health as well. And yet people tend oftentimes to make lots and lots of excuses to not do what is in their best interest. And of course, as a therapist, part of my job is really figuring out why people choose to engage in destructive and self-destructive and self-sabotaging behavior when they actually know better. You know, Gary Null talks about intentional ignorance and neglect, and that we master what we want to master. And that's one of the things that I ask my patients to do every single week when they are leaving the session, is to think about, to be mindful as they navigate their lives on a day-to-day basis and ask themselves a couple of really, really important questions. And those questions are, whatever it is that I'm doing, whether or not it is my job, whether it's my relationships, whether or not it's my colleagues, my health, my mental health, am I doing things that are really and truly in my best interest? And I think that a lot of people, because of a lot of reasons stemming from early childhood trauma, early childhood family dynamics, have not actually learned to do things that are best for them. And it's not a conscious kind of a thing. It's like we repeat history that is familiar. And so many people, you know, again, without really looking at what went on and what we need to do to not repeat history that did not work for us in our history. And of course, as children, we have absolutely no control. We have no control who our parents were. We have no control over what did or did not happen in our childhoods. But as adults, we do and we can take control over our present and over our future as best as we can if we become mindful of doing things that are in our best interest. And I talk about, of course, exercise and weight training and yoga and massage and meditation and doing things that are good for us, including having supportive people in our life. And, you know, once a year I used to ask people to take a look at who is in your life, who stays, who goes, who needs to have discussions where you're renegotiating and redesigning new kinds of relationships. But toxic people, including family members and so-called friends, they can kill us in all kinds of ways, emotionally, psychologically, and even physically, if we allow them to do it. So I'm asking you, and to be really honest with yourself, if you look at the people in your life, do you have a group of people who respect you and love you and who are supportive of you? Or on the other hand, do you have people who disrespect you, who make you crazy, who put you down, who encourage you to self-doubt yourself across the board? And I'm not suggesting that when we have difficulties in our relationships that we should be eliminating our family and our friends. But what is really, really important is that we do not allow and enable dysfunctional, toxic behavior. And what that means is setting limits. And if there are people in your life who are disrespecting you and who are hurting you and who are upsetting you, including friends, the most important thing that we can do is to have the conversation and see whether or not there is a possibility of working things out. And that means sitting down and being honest and saying what you said and what you did was really, really hurtful to me. And I love you and I want the relationship, but I cannot continue to tolerate your treating me in a disrespectful way. And then you find out. And it's only when things really start to bottom out in relationships are we able to find out who really cares and who is really committed to working through the issues. And that's why in my Never Make a Mistake in Love Again program, based on my book, For Better, For Worse, Forever, Discover the Path to Lasting Love. And for those of you who've been listening to the show for the last few years, you know that I developed a 10-step formula based on my research with 450 people that teaches people how to assess who's right for you and who's wrong for you before committing to any serious relationship. And of course, the serious relationship that I'd referred to when I was doing the research were, you know, romantic relationships, but it applies to all kinds of relationships. It's not just romantic relationships, and the kinds of people that we want in our life, including romantic relationships, are people who have the ability to be able to work through issues when issues arise. And issues are always arising. And this is why emotional communication and problem solving are such important skills. And unfortunately, you know, most of us, we did not learn about healthy emotional communication and problem solving. But, you know, like tennis, like your serve in tennis or forehand or backhand, if you're finding that you are lacking in certain skills, the question, of course, then becomes, what are you going to do about it? I mean, you can continue to blame other people for why the relationships are not working in your life, but it's important for all of us to take an honest look at ourselves and an honest look at our behavior and an honest look of some of the things that perhaps we need to change in order to be able to be a better partner, be a better friend, be a better family member. So it is a responsibility that I feel that that we need to really take very, very seriously, because it is far too easy to blame in the world and to blame other people for the problems that we continue to happen. But enabling toxicity, encouraging toxicity of any kind, puts us in a very, very dangerous position emotionally and physically. So again, I want you to look honestly around at your friends, at your family, at your partners, at your colleagues, and see whether or not the relationships that you really deserve and the relationships that you want. And if not, it's about what are you going to try to do about it. Things like positive visualization and, you know, dancing and listening to music and turning off the computers and the cell phones can really also make all the difference in the world. So are you on board? Are you finding that on a day-to-day basis, you generally, of course, every day, you know, there are intrusions and distractions in our life, but do you find that most days you are really doing what is in your best interest? And, you know, it's something that I think that we all need to ponder. And if we find that there are certain things that are really off track, then we have to make a decision. Are we going to go down the same old road, getting the same old results? Or are we going to be brave? Or are we going to be honest? And it is amazing how we ourselves are able to transform a lot of things in our life if we give ourselves permission to be introspective, and if we give ourselves permission to break the mold and to take some new kinds of action. You know, I read a study over the weekend that I found to be pretty upsetting, and this is an American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. And I want to cite you some of the suicide statistics in this country. And, well, this data is the most accurate. We estimate that the numbers to be higher. So listen to what is going on in the United States currently. I don't know whether you know, but suicide is the 10th leading cause of death in the United States. In 2017, and these are the latest statistics, almost 50,000 Americans died by suicide. In 2017, there were an estimated 1.5 million suicide attempts. And in 2015, suicide and self-injury cost the United States approximately $69 billion. And what was interesting, too, for me, and we were discussing this last week, in 2017, men died by suicide 3.5 times more often than women, and that white males accounted for 69.67% of suicide deaths in 2017, and the rate of suicide is highest in middle-aged white men in particular. So you have to kind of wonder, what is it that's going on and not going on in the lives of middle-aged white men in particular? You figure they're in the middle of their careers. Probably most are either married or divorce with children. And I think that what is so important, you know, you look at all the commercials on television and on the internet, I think that we have to do, and it's changing somewhat, to do a much, much better job in encouraging people on the internet, on television, in the media, that it is okay, that is okay whether or not you're a man or a woman or whether or not you're an adolescent, that if things are starting to really get off track, that you're feeling terrible, that your depression is completely out of control, that there are resources, and not expensive resources, where you can reach out. In fact, I have a current patient who fortunately is in a wonderful, wonderful place right now. And during the last couple of years, she's really gone through some incredible difficulty. And, you know, she told me that she would be on the suicide hotlines almost every single night during various different times in between her therapy with me, and I was seeing her twice a week. And yet she found that when it was time for her to go to sleep, the thoughts of suicide, her depression was really over the top. The food that she was consuming was not doing the trick, and that the suicide hotlines really, really kept her alive during many, many difficult nights. And I think that that's something that we need to be able to let the consumer know, to let people know that there are resources. And she just could not say enough about the suicide hotlines, about the kindness, the gentleness, how people were there. And of course, that's their job, or if they're volunteering, to really help people get through some of the most difficult, difficult times of their life. In 2017, the highest suicide rate, 20.2%, was among adults between 45 and 54 years of age. And interestingly, but not surprising, the second highest rate occurred in those people who were 85 years or older. But what has become very, very alarming is what's been happening in the world of adolescence. And we're seeing a real, real spike. And for example, in 2015, approximately 575,000 people visited a hospital for injuries due to self-harm. And based on a 2017 youth risk behavior survey, and listen to these numbers, 7.4% of youth in grades 9 to 12, that's almost 8% of the kids who are in middle school, reported that they had made at least one suicide attempt in the past 12 months. female students attempted almost twice as often as male students at almost 10%. Black students reported the highest rate of attempt, almost 10%, with white students at 6%. And here we have approximately 2.4% of all students reported making a suicide attempt that required treatment by a doctor or nurse. And when I go back and I think about the school social services program that I oversaw with a couple of colleagues in Greater Montreal, we were not seeing at that point suicide attempts with the younger children. But what we were seeing were kids that were out of control with their behavior, kids that were not doing well in school, kids that were acting out, kids who were isolated. And what was so terrific about the program in Montreal, for example, if a teacher felt, and it wasn't just the acting out kid, a kid that was too quiet, a kid that was not participating, a kid who was not doing well in school, referrals were made. Referrals were made to the school psychologist to do some testing. Maybe there was a learning problem. Referrals were made to the school social workers who were available on a very, very regular basis. I remember when I started off in Montreal as a school social worker, I was in schools 3 to 4 times a week from 9 in the morning till 4 in the afternoon. And there was a system in place, and everybody knew, the parents knew, the kids knew, the staff knew, that if we were concerned and we were not over patrolling and we were not over policing and we were not over parenting, but if we saw kids that we felt were struggling in any significant kind of way, referrals were made. And what was so terrific about that program is that really there was no child that was left behind, so that it became a very normative thing within the Montreal school system that kids who had issues, and the kids, they actually enjoyed. It was really kind of an occasion for them to come to see the school social worker or the school psychologist, and there was not a stigma. We made it as something that was just part and parcel of what kids may perhaps need at different times in their scholastic life. They needed sports, they needed recess, and at times they actually needed to talk to somebody, so that when I look at these statistics, I guess I kind of wonder what is going on. What is going on in schools across America? And you cannot be a counselor and be assigned 100 kids or 50 kids. I mean, at most, the caseloads that my staff had were between 25 and 30, and not every child needed to be seen every single week. But it was a manageable caseload, so that kids knew that they had an opportunity if things arose in their lives where they were not doing well, that they would have somebody to talk to. And, you know, I remember some of the little kids in elementary school who I worked with. And, of course, in those days, we did home visits. We went to the families. The families were involved in whatever what was going on with the kids. And I remember I always believed that people should pay something for services, not crazy, crazy amounts that so many people are charging, for example, here in New York City. But the children, when they came to see me, what I wanted from them was a blue bubble gum. And every single child that came to see me, the little kids, they would arrive with a blue bubble gum. And that was their commitment. That was their commitment to the counseling that they were receiving. So suicide is it's certainly an issue in this country. And, you know, in breaking down what people what they were doing when it came to, suicide attempts, it seems as if that firearms were the most common method of death by suicide, accounting for a little bit more than 50% of all suicide deaths. And the next most common methods were suffocation. So, again, what I am hoping to encourage you to do is that if you are feeling suicidal, if you are feeling severely depressed, the suicide hotlines are certainly a great place to begin. And there are social service agencies, and there are pastors, and there are rabbis, and that you do not need to navigate this world, this stressful world on your own. There was another interesting moving away from suicide to something a little bit more positive here. There was a really interesting piece in the, it was Thrive Global, actually, because so many people these days are walking around and they're stressed and they're exhausted and they're tired and they don't know what to do. And this article dealt with the three things to do today if you are feeling exhausted. Science-backed strategies for getting your energy back, okay, without having to overdose on caffeine. And I think the first thing is really figuring out what is it that is really zapping you where you are feeling just so overly exhausted. Is it work? Is it your relationships with friends, with partners, with kids? Is it money that is really stressing you out? Or is it social media? I mean, people are just over the top when it comes to being on social media, waiting for the likes, waiting to see whether or not the phones are going to be ringing. And I know that it totally makes me crazy. And I'm finding, in fact, I was discussing this with my husband, Jim. I am finding that I'm putting my phone away more and more and more. And if anybody really wants to contact me, they can email me or they can call me. I do not want to have this symbiotic relationship with my phone because I'm finding that it is really, really, really addictive. So what does the science-based research tell us about how to de-stress and the three things that we need to do if we're feeling really exhausted? Because most of us in life, we have multiple roles. We're caregivers, we're partners, we're parents, we're friends, we're co-workers, bosses, community members, and we are juggling a lot. I feel that we are juggling way, way too much. And this is what the research found. And you can ask yourself whether or not this is something that you would like to try. I'm always interested in evidence-based research. And the first thing that they say is that we need to stop multitasking. I mean, don't you find you're on the phone, you're watching TV, you may be writing, you may be in the kitchen, you may be running around. So this research is saying to stop it, to stop multitasking, because when we're exhausted, it can be very tempting to try and juggle as many tasks as possible so we can, at least in theory, finish earlier and then rest. But in practice, apparently, multitasking doesn't help. It makes us more tired. And when we try and take on too many things at once, it's harder for us to focus and actually decreases productivity, according to the American Psychological Association. And furthermore, researchers at Stanford University reviewed more than a decade's worth of data on multitasking and found that people, listen to this, that people who engage with multiple types of media at the same time performed worse on memory-related tasks. So that if you are exhausted, do your brain a favor and only focus on one task at a time, beginning today, and then you can let me know whether or not you are feeling less exhausted. And number two, and I find this to be absolutely right on, which is to spend some time in nature, or at least looking at it, so that if you're already working with depleted energy levels, you probably try and avoid any additional movement or stimuli. But spending some time in nature can leave you feeling energized, and you don't need to take a week or even a full day off to reap the benefits of the great outdoors. Spending even 20 minutes walking outdoors can help reduce stress and make us feel better, according to a recent study published in Frontiers magazine. So as a first step, you can just give yourself permission today and at least take a walk around your office when you are on a lunch break. Hopefully you are going to see some trees and some nature and not just concrete. And when you're around your home, hopefully there's some grass. Maybe there is a park nearby where you can just take some deep breaths and just look around in the beauty and the nature. At least it does for me. I find that if I'm feeling really stressed, we live on Riverside Park here in New York City. Just going for a walk, and I mostly take Cha-Cha, our little dog, with us, and just looking at the trees and looking at the flowers and looking at people who are walking around in the beauty of the park, it certainly helps me to de-stress. And it's really true. It doesn't take hours and hours to do this. Just 20 minutes or 25 minutes of just getting outside and moving around, for me, is one of the best energizers and de-stressors. And the third thing that this research has found is the importance and benefit of taking a nap. And this is very, very consistent with what is going on with people in Sardinia. And I talk about this a lot, who tend to live the longest. They eat healthily. They interact and socialize. They sleep 8 hours a night, and they take regular naps. Now, for people who are working full time, it's very difficult in the middle of the day, obviously, to just say, hey, I'm leaving and I'm going to take a nap. And, you know, I've been reading that more and more workspaces are really recognizing the importance of some of this recent research and are really encouraging employees to just even doze off for 10 minutes, and you can end up feeling a lot more refreshed. So what they are finding with the studies is that if we're able to take a 20-minute nap, chances are we'd be more creative, productive, and efficient. And listen to this. According to a 2006 study published in the journal Sleep, even a 10-minute nap produced immediate improvements, including increased cognitive performance and decreased sleeplessness. So are you going to be willing to take in some of what I think is some really, really important science-backed strategy to help you feel less exhausted every single day? So I certainly hope you are going to take this very, very seriously and do something about this today. Well, I was very excited. A couple days ago, in the business section of the New York Times, the lead story was Sex Sells, Walmart Buys In. So here we have a story about the retail giant Walmart, who was teaming with a small Massachusetts company to create a line of erotic toys. So I read the story, and the president of this small Massachusetts company, his name is Jamie Leventhal, who I immediately called, by the way, over the weekend. He's the chief executive of a company called Clio. And what he says is, he says, I want to become the Kleenex of sex toys. He said, the brand that you associate with sex toys. So what was very interesting was that last year, Jamie Leventhal, and I'm really hoping to get together with him within the next little while, who is the chief executive of Clio, he receives this call from a buyer at Walmart. And this buyer asks him, what do you think of going into the sex toy manufacturing part of your company? And I think that he was a bit taken aback because that was not something that Mr. Leventhal was doing. But apparently now Clio's, it's called Clio's Plus One line, is in 4,300 of Walmart's roughly 4,700 stores. And of course, wearing my sex therapy hat, I think this is really a terrific, terrific thing to normalize people's feelings and values about sexuality. And, you know, he's hoping to be able to appeal to women. And I need to talk to him whether or not the primary target group is really going to be women who have never bought a sex toy before, particularly mothers over 25, but are embracing the idea that sexual wellness is good for you. And of course it is, and can be very, very empowering. And then in the story, he was saying that he has to figure out how to market a device that some in the public still view with suspicion. Well, of course, and of course, I want to be involved in all of this. And I don't know whether I'd ever mentioned to you, but I was the spokesperson for a penis pump a number of years ago that was manufactured by Encore Premium Delight. And what we were trying to do was to let people know is that if there was issues, whether or not with erectile dysfunction or whether people were having any kind of sexual problems, that it was okay. It was okay for them to use whatever devices, including Viagra and Cialis and Levitra and penis pumps, in order to be able to improve the quality of their sex lives. Because the fact is that in this country, we are not doing very well in the bedroom. And it seems as if perhaps that we are, because we're living in this very sexualized society. But the fact is that, for example, if you're looking at frequency in France, couples engage in a variety of different sexual activities about three times a week. In the United States, couples are having sex about two times a month. So we're stressed, we are exhausted, we're depressed, there are a lot of other issues going on. But in fact, if people are really wanting to have good sex lives, I mean, whether or not you have a partner, and if you don't have a partner, I strongly encourage people to use whatever devices that they would like to experiment with, including vibrators. And, you know, in New York, there are many different really upscale sex stores where you can go in and you can take a look at there are thousands of different kinds of toys that that individuals and couples are using to enhance their sex lives. And it's all good. And if you are one of these people who is reluctant, it may be interesting for you to just check it out. It doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with you. These are all things that can actually help to enhance your sex lives. But I think it's important, you know, we're looking at why are Americans having as little sex as they are. I think it's important to take a look at, you know, why this phenomenon is actually happening. And of course, if people are feeling depressed or anxious, or if they are, you know, suffering from a variety of different kinds of psychiatric problems, I mean, that will always interfere with your desire. For people who have been sexually abused or sexually assaulted, these are issues that really have to be sorted through. In fact, there is a wonderful, wonderful show on HBO. It's called Sex and Lies. I think Sex and Lies with Nicole Kidman. And there was a scene, one of the women in the show, she had been raped. In fact, as a result of the rape, she gave birth to an absolutely beautiful, beautiful little boy. And the boy is about, probably 6 or 7 years of age. And it seems as if she hadn't dated, she hadn't had a relationship. And she started in the show to date what appeared to be a really, really lovely man. And each and every time they were trying to engage in sex, I mean, she was having some serious, serious, post-traumatic reactions. So that for people who have been assaulted, for people who have been raped, I mean, these are issues that will always, always get in the way of desire, of your sex life. So this is where people really do need to get some help, because it is so easy to be living in the past, and if not on a conscious level, on an unconscious level, where touch equals rape, touch equals force, touch equals powerlessness. So these are things that absolutely have to be dealt with. So again, whether or not there are mental health issues, whether or not there was early child sexual abuse or rape or sexual harassment, these will invariably impact your sex life unless you are prepared and willing to acknowledge and address and resolve issues as best as you can, knowing, of course, that we cannot change our history. And something else that we really have to look at are our hormones. And, as we get older, our hormone levels change. And it's not just for men, because for men, in an estimated 30 to 40% of men over the age of 50 have low testosterone. You know, I'll hear this all the time, where men may have little desire or they are having some issues with erection. And one of the first things that I will ask is, have you had a testosterone level test? And for many men, they have not. So that if you are a man who has little sexual desire and may be also having some issues with erection, the very best thing that you can do, before just asking for a Viagra or a Cialis or a Levitra, is to have your testosterone levels done. And it may be that you need some testosterone replacement. And that's something that you need to discuss with your physician. And it really can make a huge difference. And also for women, because as we age, particularly postmenopausal women, our estrogen levels go down, our testosterone, and yes, women also have testosterone levels, they also go down, and our progesterone levels go down. So this is something, too, that we need to address. Now, a lot of women, including myself, did not want to go on any hormone replacement therapy because there were concerns about cancer. But these are things that we need to rule out, and these are things that we need to discuss with our physicians. And it may be that you are needing a little bit of extra help because lubrication is not what it was before. So again, I think it's important that we become students, that we become smart consumers when it comes to our relationships, when it comes to our health, and when it also comes to our sex lives. And also, you know, what about the medication that you may be taking? Antidepressant medication across the board has serious, serious sexual side effects to a greater or lesser degree. And I am not suggesting at all for those of you who are on antidepressant medication or other psychiatric medications that you stop taking your pills, of course. But again, this is something that needs to be discussed with your physician, because oftentimes a change in dose or a change in family of medication can make all the difference in the world. And you know, it's interesting, I had a patient who saw a physician just a couple of days ago. She's on many different psychiatric drugs and is in a brand new relationship and has little, if any. Actually, she has zero sexual desire. She feels nothing sexually at all. So she went to see a doctor. She went to see a gynecologist. And I said, listen, I really want you to go through the list of all the different medicines that you are on that may help to explain why it is that you have zero sexual desire, even though she's in a nice relationship with a nice man. And the relationship may very well be at risk because she simply has no desire for, you know, sex of any kind. So she went to see this doctor, this very well-known New York City gynecologist, who she told me was completely disinterested in all of the different meds that she was on. Now, I'm not a doctor, so I was not able to tell her exactly, you know, what possible sexual side effects she would be experiencing from. This woman is on probably 15 different kinds of pills. She has different urological problems, and she has sleep issues. So he was not interested. So I had actually suggested to her that she sit down with the head pharmacist at one of the drugstores that she deals with, and that the pharmacist may take out the PDR and take a look at what possible sexual side effects this woman is experiencing from all of the different pills. And again, maybe a slight change in medicine could help explain away why she has zero sexual desire of any kind. So again, we have to be really, really savvy consumers. And of course, these days, you know, on the internet, even though I'm always suggesting that we limit the amount of time that we're spending online, we're able to at least get some kind of ideas, perhaps, of why certain things are happening to our bodies, and perhaps we can get some new information that would help us figure out, more importantly, what we need to do. And of course, if we're feeling stressed out, the last thing that the majority of people are really going to want to do, if you're stressed out, is think about having sex. Or perhaps, you know, you may have a thyroid issue. And you know, I think that, you know, so many doctors these days, they're busy and they are overbooked with patients that we don't really think about in conversations to rule out, to go through all of the different things that could be impacting our lack of sexual desire. So here we have Michael Eisenberg, who is the director of male reproductive medicine and surgery at Stanford. And he says that if you have a lack of sex drive, that may mean that you have thyroid disease resulting in low levels of thyroid hormone. Now, most consumers, we would never think of anything like that at all. And other symptoms of a thyroid condition include fatigue, weakness, cold sensitivity, weight gain, dry skin. And since our thyroid is essential for maintaining many body systems, a lack of thyroid function or excess thyroid function can cause sex drive disturbances. So again, talking to your doctor, who may run tests and prescribe medications such as thyroid replacement. So it's always about trying to get to the root of the problem rather than simply putting a bandage on the issue, because unless we figure out exactly what is it that's going on, what is it that is contributing to our problems, our health, our sex life, our relationships, we tend to then just kind of go around in circles. And if you're having sleep troubles, this is something obviously that is going to be affecting your energy level. And with fatigue, I think that if we're feeling really, really fatigued, many people are simply going to want to go to sleep, right? And that's just the way it is for the majority of people. So, and we're looking at other things, erectile dysfunction, a heart condition could definitely be at play here, or you may be dealing with another underlying illness that is impacting your sex life or your lack of sexual desire. So what I'm really hoping, and I'm really hoping to be able to talk to Jamie Leventhal and see whether or not I cannot get involved in some way with his new venture with Walmart in giving people permission and encouragement to do whatever it is that they want to do or whatever it is that they would like to experiment with in order to put the sizzle in their sex lives. So, you know, I'm looking at all of the different things here that I wanted to, different articles that I really wanted to talk about. There was a piece on parents, panicked parents who are hiring screen time consultants because they simply have not been able to say no to their children who are on their phones and their computers. And I think we're going to be able to talk about that next week. And there was another piece that really was interesting on the fluidity of gender, language, and the human experience, and how people these days, it's no longer just talking about men and women and male and female, and the fluidity and the non-binary continuum is something that I would also like to be able to address with you in some detail within the next couple of weeks. So everybody, it seems as if another hour has come and gone here on the Ask Beatty show, and I really hope that every single week that there is some little thing that I can say, some little suggestion that I have made that is going to help you and motivate you and encourage you to do what is in your best interest, and that may very, very well be to reaching out to somebody and asking for help, because it is way too difficult in this world to navigate this life on our own, and we don't need to do it. It's always a good thing to be able to hold on to somebody else and have them help you, have them help us live lives that are more productive and just more functional. So I'm hoping that I have convinced you, and I'm hoping that I will continue to convince you that if you're having some difficulties, that the very best thing you can do is definitely, definitely reach out and ask for help. And I want to leave you with my two weekly messages that I really hope you're going to take in. And the first is to do everything that you can possibly do to find ways to love yourself and to do what's in your best interest. And the second thing, of course, is that we all need to do a much, much better job in finding ways to love each other. So goodbye, everybody, and I will talk with you next week. Have a good rest of the day, and do take care. Bye-bye. Another mountain. There are mountains and hillsides enough to climb. There are oceans and rivers enough to cross, enough to last till the end of time.